Well, good morning. I was telling Tom and Debbie earlier, I've been leading into these services with, hey, where two or three are gathered, and I was afraid I was only going to be able to say, have to stop at two today. But we are glad those that are here are here. I know just with the chaos of a 4th of July weekend on top of the rise in COVID cases and everything that has happened this week, and we kind of expected a low crowd today. And for those that are going to watch this on the filmed version, I'm sorry, our live stream, for some reason, we just lost that too. So we are going to record it, and it'll be uploaded later. So I'm just speaking to you guys right now. So we're glad that you are here. We are, just so I can practice this announcement, you all are doing a good job. We are. Our district has said that, and we agree, that that masks are now, we are at a kind of a necessary spot with those. And so we are asking everyone to, if you're not up here speaking on the stage or on a mic, to be wearing a mask. So thank you all for participating in that this morning. I know that I'm hoping you all got a little communion packet when you walked in. If you'll just hold on to that during our communion service, we will walk you through that, and we'll take communion together this morning as well. Also want to tell you about a women's conference that we have coming up. It's going to be a live-streamed women's conference. It is in August, and the registrations for that will probably be online for our church to do that. And we're not exactly sure how that plays out, whether it will be all together in kind of the worship environment, or if there'll be individual places. Just depends on kind of where we are with our protocols at that point. So, but just take note of that. And again, just a reminder that our offering baskets are at the doors on your way out this morning. But again, we are so glad for those that are here. We are so glad that you are here, and we know that God is here with us, and God is present and always. And so, welcome to worship.
Let's stand and sing together this morning.
Done great things. We dance your freedom. great things.
Most gracious and loving God, we are so grateful to have the opportunity to gather here this morning to worship you. We are blessed, in spite of all the restrictions and safeguards, to live in a place where we have the freedom to gather and to worship. We all know that our country and our world is far from perfect. And our shortcomings and flaws are often far too obvious. But we know how fortunate we are to have the opportunities that we do have. And for that, we thank you. We come this morning, too, asking for your continued healing and protection over our community, our country, and our world. This unique virus has taken its toll on so many aspects of our lives and our relationships. And we come asking for your continued love and presence as we look forward to the day that we can gather with no more masks and can greet each other with a hug. We love you. We thank you for the promises that you have given us and fulfilled in our Savior, Jesus Christ. We come this morning praying the prayer that you taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever.
Standing in worship.
For we trust in our God, and through His unfailing love, we will not be shaken. We will not be shaken. We will not be shaken. Against us on all sides, We will not be shaken. We will not be shaken. We will not be shaken. For in the hour of our darkest day, we will not tremble. We won't be afraid. Hope is rising like the light of dawn. Our God is for us. He has overcome. For we trust in our God, and through His unfailing love, we will not be shaken. We will not be shaken. We will not be shaken.
So I want to welcome you again this morning. It's always a little strange for me in the Ignite service because I don't get to say hello to you until toward the end of the service. But thank you for being here. Thank you for being here. And thanks to the, I know we're not streaming right now, but there will be those who will watch this later. I want to say thanks to you for worshiping with us online. It's our privilege to worship with you, whether in person or online. So thank you for being here. So this morning, I want to begin a sermon series on the minor prophets. The minor prophets. Now, they're called minor not because they are less important. They're called minor simply because of the size of the book. They're small in comparison to like Isaiah or Jeremiah or Ezekiel. They're small in size, but they are big in message. They are big in message. They also, if the messages are heated, and the messages of the minor prophets are often very, very harsh, very strong, if they are heeded, they lead those who heed their messages into the goodness of God, into the goodness of God. So I heard a story years ago from a preacher. He was telling about a time he was having a meal at an upscale restaurant with a well-known, well-respected theologian. And just before the meal, the theologian reached out and picked up the small dessert fork on the table, and he held it up. And he asked those around him, "Do you know what this is?" And they all said, "Yes, it's a dessert fork." And he said, "No, it is a minor prophet. It is small, but it foretells something good is coming." And so the minor prophets, they are small, but if their message is heeded, and that's the key, if their message is heeded, they lead to the goodness of God. And so what I want to do today is start with Jonah, and I'll be reading a number of passages throughout this text, or throughout this sermon, but our leading verse comes from Jonah chapter 2, verse 9. Jonah chapter 2, verse 9. But I with the voice of thanksgiving will sacrifice to you what I have vowed I will pay. Salvation belongs to the Lord. Salvation belongs to the Lord. And so over these next few weeks, I'm going to be preaching. We're going to be preaching. Jason's going to pick this up next week. I originally thought I would just title the message the name of the person, because it covers kind of the whole story of that person. But if I was going to get real specific on this one, it would be Jonah. Salvation belongs to the Lord. Salvation belongs to the Lord. So the story of Jonah is undoubtedly one of the most well-known, best-loved stories in the Bible. I mean, there are books about it and kids' books, and most people know the story of Jonah. Let me give just a brief word of context about this book. Let me start with the person, Jonah. His name literally means dove. It literally means dove, and he was a prophet in the northern part of Israel under the reign of Jeroboam II in the 8th century B.C. And so he is an ancient, ancient prophet. And unlike much of the message that so many of the minor prophets proclaimed, the messages that were proclaimed against, specifically against God's people, Jonah's message is actually directed towards another group of people. It's applicable to us, it's applicable to all, but in its original context, it was directed towards another group of people. And so with that in mind, I want to jump straight into the story of Jonah. And the first thing I want to observe is this, is that Jonah runs quickly. Jonah runs quickly. Look at verses, well, they'll be on the screen, but let me just read from chapter 1, verses 1-2. "Now the word of the Lord came to Jonah, the son of Amittai, 'Arise, go to Nineveh, the great city, and call out against it, for their evil has come up before them.'" So Nineveh is referred to as a great city in this particular book. And indeed, it was great in a number of ways. It was great in size, to be sure. It was the capital city of Assyria, and there were at least 120,000 residents of Assyria. It was located along the eastern edge of the Tigris River, and it ran alongside of the river for many, many miles. One reference says it was 30 miles in length. Another says 18. But either way, it was a large city. And not only was it large in the sense that it went so many miles along the Tigris River, it also went inland from the river about 10 miles. So it is an expansive city, to be sure. It was also a flourishing city. Was located on the trade route between the Mediterranean Sea and the Indian Oceans. And so it was a place where wealth flourished. And so, in fact, one writer says that it was the most flourishing, the greatest of all ancient cities. And yet, it was spiritually evil. It was spiritually wicked, as some translations will say. Now, the VeggieTales, if you remember VeggieTales, they depicted the wickedness of the Ninevites in that the Ninevites slapped people in the face with fish. Let me tell you, that's not even close. That's not even close to what the Ninevites did. The Ninevites truly were a wicked people, a wicked nation. Another prophet, Nahum, describes the wickedness of Nineveh this way. Nineveh was cruel. It was filled with murder and corruption. It was filled with oppression, and it was an idolatrous place. One writer says this: Nineveh was a city of violence known for its brutal treatment of those it's conquered. The Assyrians were notorious for amputating hands and feet, gouging eyes, and skinning and impaling their captives. And so it was a brutal city. And just on a side note, Friday night, we watched the movie Mudbound. If you've not seen Mudbound, I encourage you to watch it. There are some... the setting is the Mississippi Delta, World War II, and there are some scenes of absolute cruelty in that movie. You watch that and you're aghast, at least I was aghast, that happened. And certainly we know that even things like that and cruelty exist in our world today. Let me get back to the text. Assyria was a cruel, barbaric place. They were the enemy of Israel, and they would ultimately actually conquer God's people. And the word of the Lord comes to Jonah and says, I want you to go to Nineveh and call out against it. So if you're looking at an ancient map, I should have put one up here, but I didn't. If you're looking at an ancient map, where Jonah is located in northern Israel, that would be a call to go about 550 miles northeast to Nineveh. But you know what Jonah does, right? Jonah actually goes down to the port city of Joppa, catches a ship headed for Tarshish, which is 2,500 miles to the west. It is as far to the west as you could almost possibly go. It's on the other end of the Mediterranean Sea, what we would now call Spain. So, I mean, literally, the Lord said, I want you to go to Nineveh, and Jonah goes in the exact opposite direction. That's what you call fleeing from the Lord. So I want to point out another quick note, just on a side note, and that is the text tells us that Jonah pays a fare, he pays a price to get on the ship to flee from God. And the reality is rebellion against God will always cost us. It will always cost us something. Someone long ago said something like this: sin will cost you more than you ever wanted to pay, it will take you further than you ever wanted to go, and it will keep you longer than you ever wanted to stay. Jonah hears the word of the Lord, and he runs quickly in the opposite direction. But he also prays passionately. He prays passionately. You can run from God, but you cannot outrun God. How many of you know that, right? You can run from God, but you cannot outrun God. And so the Lord sends a storm upon the ship, you remember? And the crew, they become aware that this storm is connected somehow to Jonah being there. They know that he is fleeing from the Lord. And they ask Jonah, if you remember at the end of chapter 1, they ask Jonah, what are we supposed to do? And Jonah's like, pick me up, throw me into the ocean. And so they don't want to upset God. I mean, they know that Jonah is the Lord's man. And so they say, okay, they pray this prayer, Lord, don't hold this against us. And they pitch him into the water. Immediately, the sea becomes clear. The sea becomes calm. Jonah is sinking to the depths of the bottom of the ocean when suddenly the Lord appoints a giant fish. We think the fish was a bad thing. The fish is what rescued Jonah. The fish is what saved him. The Lord appoints a fish to swallow him. Now, we have this beautiful, eloquent prayer in Jonah chapter 2. But it's important to note that that eloquent prayer in chapter 2 actually is it was prayed while safely inside the fish's belly. But it is depicting the prayer. It's referring back to the prayer that Jonah prayed as he was sinking to the bottom of the ocean. So I want to read this prayer from Jonah chapter 2. You probably remember these words. He says, I called out to the Lord out of my distress, and he answered me. Out of the belly of Sheol I cried, and you heard my voice. You cast me into the deep, into the heart of the seas, and the flood surrounded me. All your waves and your billows passed over me. And then I said, I am driven away from your sight, yet I shall again look upon your holy temple. The waters closed in over me to take my life. The deep surrounded me. Weeds were wrapped about my head at the roots of the mountains. I went down to the land whose bars closed upon me forever. Yet you brought up my life from the pit. O Lord, my God, when my life was fainting away, I remembered the Lord, and my prayer came to you into your holy temple. Those who pay regard to vain idols forsake their hope of steadfast love, but I, with the voice of thanksgiving, will sacrifice to you what I have vowed I will pay. Salvation belongs to the Lord. And the Lord spoke to the fish, and it vomited Jonah up onto dry land. Jonah teaches us the importance of praying passionately when we are in the depths of life. When we are in the depths of life, it's okay to pray and to call out passionately to God when we are in the depths, even if the depths are self-inflicted. I want to say that again. Even if the depths are self-inflicted. I mean, seriously, because I think some of us sometimes find ourselves in self-inflicted depths. And we're like, you know what, I'm just gonna take my lumps. I'm just going to get what's coming to me. I mean, this is what I'm supposed to do, and the Lord's not going to hear my cry. Listen, Jonah teaches all of us that when we find ourselves in the depths of life, even if it's self-inflicted, God is there, he listens, he hears us, and we are to call out to him. Now, we know that there are consequences for this, and we understand that, but all through the Bible, I mean, all through the Bible, people find themselves in depths, dark places, some of them self-inflicted even, and they call out to God, and he rescues them. So maybe at this moment, you are in a place of darkness. You are in a sinking place. I want you to know God hears you. He loves you. Call out to him wherever you may be. Number three, Jonah serves obediently. So he runs quickly, prays passionately, but he serves obediently. I want to read the first few verses from chapter 3. Then the word of the Lord came to Jonah the second time. So the God of second chances shows up in Jonah's life. And he says, arise, go to Nineveh, the great city, and call out against it the message that I tell you. So Jonah arose and went to Nineveh according to the word of the Lord. And so Jonah receives a second opportunity to do what God wants him to do. He goes to Nineveh. He goes to Nineveh, and he proclaims the word of the Lord. The people hear it, and they repent, and an awakening happens. An awakening happens. It starts with the people. They begin to turn away from their sins. And then it goes to the king. The king himself hears the word of the Lord. The king issues a decree. The decree says, let everybody in Nineveh turn away from their sins and turn to the Lord. And a great awakening happens. They experience the grace of God because they comply with the demands of God. I want to say it like this. The love of God can only be fully experienced when the demands of God are met. Now listen, God loves us whether we're obedient or not, okay? We know that. He loves us unconditionally whether we are obedient or not. But we will never fully experience the fullness of God's love until we get on the same page with God. We just can't possibly do that. He loves us unconditionally, but we never fully experience the fullness of God's love until we're willing to say, yes, Lord, I want to do what you want me to do, and I'm going to be who you've called me to be. And so Jonah serves obediently. What a great comeback that is. But then number four, Jonah is displeased exceedingly. He's displeased exceedingly. So I want to read to you the first few verses, of chapter 4. Chapter 4 goes like this. But it displeased Jonah exceedingly, and he was angry. And he prayed to the Lord and said, O Lord, is this not what I said when I was in my country? That is why I made haste to flee to Tarshish, for I knew that you are a gracious God and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love and relenting from disaster. Therefore, now, O Lord, please take my life from me, for it is better for me to die than to live. And the Lord said, do you do well to be angry? There it is. That was Jonah's whole reason. And we know this, right? Because we've read the story. But that's why Jonah was fleeing to Tarshish. Jonah absolutely hated. He detested the Ninevites. And he knew that if he went to Nineveh and he preached the word of God and they responded to the word of God, God would forgive them. God would forgive them. And it outraged Jonah so much that he ran away. Jonah is totally inconsistent here with his own experience of God's mercy and goodness. Think about this for a moment. He's totally inconsistent with his own experience of God's goodness. Tim Keller makes this great reference to the parable of the prodigal son. Tim Keller says, in this moment, in this story, Jonah is both like the younger son in the parable of the prodigal son, but he's also like the older son in the parable of the prodigal son. As the younger son, Jonah was the one who went away, fled from the father, but the father rescued him. God rescued him. But as soon as he's rescued, he becomes the older son. And now he's angry that the Ninevites are receiving the grace and mercy of God. I mean, Jonah, he becomes exceedingly angry because God pours out his mercy and grace upon these people. You remember the Lord's reply? There's this moment after Jonah just gets real honest with God. This is why I'm mad. I'm mad because you're going to pour your mercy and grace upon those brutal, wicked, awful people. Jonah goes outside to mope. And as he's moping, the Lord raises up, creates this tree or a plant to grow up high above him to shade him. And the Bible says that Jonah was so glad when that tree provided shade. But the Lord wanted to teach an object lesson here. And so the Lord sends a worm to destroy that plant or tree. And the plant dies. And once again, when the shade tree dies and the sun beats down on Jonah, Jonah then becomes despondent once again. And the Lord says to Jonah, Jonah, you have pity on this plant that I created. You had nothing to do with this, but you pity this plant that died. Shouldn't I have pity on 120,000 Ninevites who don't know right from wrong? What an incredible statement that is. Let me tell you something. God's grace may make you angry. God's grace may make you angry. It can. Seriously, when God begins to pour his mercy and his grace upon people that we just know don't deserve it, and yet that is the story. That is the story of Jonah. He runs quickly, prays passionately, serves obediently, but then he is displeased exceedingly because of the grace and mercy of God. So that's an ancient story. What does that have to do with you and me in our own lives? A couple of thoughts in closing. The first is this, as we learn from Jonah, respond faithfully. Respond faithfully. And from the perspective of Jonah, responding faithfully means saying yes when God tells us to do something. It means saying, God, I will follow you wherever you lead. Saying yes, responding faithfully from the perspective of Jonah is about being willing to do what God calls us to do. There are many reasons, aren't there, why people flee from the Lord? You can probably think of some. There are many reasons, fear or worry or just self-control or whatever. I mean, there are many reasons why people run away from God. What is the Lord calling us to do at this moment? What's the Lord calling you to do? So I'll speak personally for myself. I mean, for me personally, over the last several months, I have this real renewed call, this renewed passion to just preach God's word as faithfully as I know how to do and let the chips fall where they may. Just to preach God's word. Now, there's a place for theological debate and discussion and conversation, of course, but in the Bible, the most common, the most overwhelming commonality or the most overwhelming way the preacher would preach would simply be to stand up and say, "This is what God says." Now, sometimes they got killed for doing that, or run out of town, or thrown in jail. I'm going on vacation tomorrow, thanks be to God. But that's this renewed passion that I have in my heart to be able to stand up and just say, "Hey, listen, this is what God says. This is who God is. He's awesome. He's holy. And this is what His Word declares." That's just one example of what God's saying to me. We all have different calls in our lives. What is God calling you to? I mean, really, what is it in your heart that's stirring right now and you find yourself perhaps wanting to run away? Don't run away. Whatever that may be, say yes to Him, whatever that may be. But from the perspective of Nineveh, to respond faithfully means to repent. Repentance is a bad word in most of our churches. We don't like to use that word, but it's a glorious word. It just simply means to turn away from the things that lead us away from God and to turn back to God. Perhaps our sin is like the Ninevites. Perhaps our sin is like the Ninevites. We're cruel. We don't treat people well. Maybe we don't murder people, but we, as Jesus says, we murder people with the words that we say. We're wired. Some of us are just wired to go on attack mode. Maybe that's who you are. So perhaps my sin is like the Ninevites. I'm cruel. I don't look out for the well-being of others, and I have this tendency to launch out at people. Or perhaps my sin is like Jonah. Perhaps my sin is like Jonah. There are certain kinds of people that I just don't like. Maybe that's our sin. There are certain kinds of people that just turn us off from the beginning. And whether that's based on race or politics or ideology or whatever the case may be. So I'll do a little confession here. I think Jonah's sin is my sin from time to time. And I don't think it's based on race. I really don't. Now, I want to be clear. I think all of us, red, yellow, black, and white, we all struggle with prejudice and bigotry and racism. Every one of us, we all struggle with that. It's part of the broken, fallen human nature. We better get right with that. We better get right with that now. We all struggle with that. But primarily, I don't think that's my main issue. I think my main issue is that there are people who hold worldviews or ideologies that when they begin to talk or write articles or I see them on television, I like turn them off, turn around, and walk away. I'm like, I cannot stomach that anymore. Maybe that's our sin. It's the sin of Jonah. There are just people out there we don't like. Or maybe our sin is a combination of Nineveh's sin and Jonah's sin, and that's the sin of idolatry. See, idolatry is just putting anything above God. Our own personal agenda, our own desires, our own wants. I mean, we could unpack that. I mean, it's putting the way that I want to use my resources, my time, my talent, my treasure over how God tells me to. It could be anything. It could be about sexual immorality. It could be about anything. Maybe that's our sin. And I think if we're going to respond as the Ninevites responded, we say, "Lord, today I will choose to turn to You and to Your goodness. You're so good. You are so awesome." The second thing I'd say, and this is in closing, is if we are to respond faithfully, at its core, it means this: we are to love people unconditionally. You can't respond faithfully without loving people unconditionally. This is the blatant struggle with Jonah, his unwillingness to love the Ninevites. And by love, I don't mean some silly, sappy sentimentalism, but the commitment to somebody else's well-being. And that's where Jonah struggled, his commitment to somebody else's well-being, a people that he didn't like, a people he didn't think deserved it. And above all, I think the story of Jonah is really a reflection of God's love for all of us offered to us through Jesus Christ. Above all, the story of Jonah is really a reflection, a picture, an ancient picture of the love of God that comes to us through the Lord Jesus Christ. And I don't just make that up. Listen to what Jesus said in Matthew chapter 12, verse 40. Jesus says, For just as Jonah was 3 days in the belly of the great fish, so will the Son of Man be 3 days and nights in the heart of the earth. He's, of course, referring to his death and burial. He's referring to that great passion, the passion of Jesus to give his life as an atoning sacrifice for the sins of the world. Out of love for us, Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. And that, Paul says, proves God's love for us. It proves it. There is perhaps no greater symbol of that love than Holy Communion. As we take the bread, his body, and we take the juice, his blood, broken and spilled for us. And so wherever you are this day, whether you find yourself in the position of Jonah running from the Lord, or you find yourself in the place of the Ninevites needing a word of deliverance and grace, may you receive that today. May you join me in our liturgy for Holy Communion. Friends, this is the table of the Lord. From the night of his arrest through succeeding generations, Jesus' disciples have continued to come to the table for this holy meal. As he did that night in Jerusalem, so ever since, and at all times and places, Christ meets us right here. We are included in this feast, whether we are filled with faith or emptied by doubt, whether we are first among saints, last among scoundrels, or somewhere in between. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. And therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We've not loved our neighbors. We've not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners, and that proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. In bread broken and cup poured out, we remember the full extent of Christ's love for us and give thanks. Come, let us join the whole communion of saints as we keep the feast. The Lord be with you and also with you. Lift up your hearts. We lift them up to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. You sent your Son Jesus for the healing of the world. Pause right there for a moment. That statement is priceless. You sent your Son Jesus for the healing of the world, that we might learn to follow his life of humility and share in the joy of glorious resurrection. So we praise you as we say, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. On the night before he died, Jesus gathered his friends for a meal. He took bread, gave you thanks, broke it, gave it to them, and said, Take, eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. After supper, he took the cup, And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "This is the cup of the new covenant in my blood, poured out for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me." Christ has died. Christ has risen. Christ will come again in glory. Gracious God, pour out your Holy Spirit on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ our Lord, that we, his body, redeemed by his blood, would be his body in this broken world in which we live. Pour your Spirit upon these elements. Meet us right where we are, and we pray this in Christ's name. Amen. There is one body, for we are one in Christ. And the cup over which we give thanks is a celebration and a communion with God our Father, the Lord Jesus Christ, the Holy Spirit, and one another. So we're going to do communion differently this morning. You received one of these little handy-dandy, I never thought I'd be using one of these, I'll be honest. But one of these little communion packets. Let me explain what we're going to do first. So there's a wafer. It's on top, and there's a little cellophane tab you got to pull back to take that. And then you pull the bigger tab for the juice. What I want to invite you to do, we're going to remain seated, and let's share together the body of Christ. I will lead us. So if you will, join with me in consuming, receiving the body of Christ first. The body of Christ. And now I invite you to open the other part, to receive the blood of Christ. Everybody, are we getting it? Everybody, I know it's a little bit. The blood of Christ shed for us. Let's pray together. Lord, your body was broken, your blood was shed for us, for the healing of the world. For the healing of the world, as we spend the next couple of minutes, as our band continues to draw us, lead us closer to your throne of grace and mercy, give us the grace to be honest, to reflect, to do business with you. You are the God of grace and mercy. You are the God of truth. You know us better than we know ourselves. Today we choose to be honest with you. To be honest with you, those of us who are Jonah's running away, we choose to say yes to you. And those who are Ninevites who need to turn back to you as Jonah needed to turn back to you, this is an opportunity to do that as well.
Oh,
gracious God, you want our hearts. Like Jonah, like the Ninevites, you welcome us back. Give us grace, Lord, to continue to believe this and not forget this. Because it's Sunday, and in a worship service, these truths are easy to remember, but on Monday morning, when we step into the world, maybe even as we leave this facility in 5 minutes, we know it's a struggle. And so, Lord, we give ourselves to you, to whatever. Yeah, we just give ourselves to you. And we entrust all of life to you. Because truly, salvation belongs to the Lord. You are our rescuer. We believe that. Amen and amen. Would you receive this benediction? Would you stand? May the God who rescues from the depths of the sea, rescues from the depths of sin and brokenness, may you see him today. May all of us open our hearts and our minds to him. And trust him this day and forevermore. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Our Father everlasting, the all-creating one, God Almighty. And through your Holy Spirit, conceiving Christ the Son, Jesus our Savior.